four takes, that's you. Three takes, not me. Two takes, if you lucky. First take, it got me.
You are almost there, but first take, happy Friday, everybody. Thank you so much for being here with us. Day two of our all-lady special, which I enjoyed so much yesterday. Marley Rivera, Anita Marks, Claudia Trejos, thank you guys so much for being back. You had fun?
Ha.
You ready for day two?
It's an understatement.
Ready to bring it again?
Yeah.
Yes. All right. Let's get everybody set for the weekend. And we just want to remind you guys, our next show this upcoming Monday will be the new era First Take. Your boy, Stephen A., is back. Woo-hoo. We miss him. And Max Kellerman will be here. We're so excited for that. Be sure to tune in. We're going to have a lot of guests and people stopping by. It's going to be a lot of fun, the new era. But meanwhile, let's get into everything that is going on today. So the NBA has decided to relocate the 2017 All-Star game from Charlotte with the hope of rescheduling for 2019. The league's decision comes over objections to a North Carolina law that limits anti-discrimination protections for lesbian, gay, and transgender people, and comes shortly after state legislatures revisited the law and chose to leave it largely unchanged. Here's Steph Curry on the decision.
Just don't know how much that would have meant to the city to be able to host, you know, the greatest, you know, NBA guys and celebrate the game of basketball. You know, I know the league is in a decision or in a position where they have to make a decision, and Adam Silver's made one, and, you know, we support that. But at the end of the day, you know, I love my city. I love Charlotte. I love everything about it. I love the people there, and I really wanted to see them, you know, celebrate the game. And it's unfortunate I won't be able to do that.
So the league says that they plan to announce a new location shortly. Of course, it will not be in Charlotte. Anita, what was your reaction to this?
Is Adam Silver not your favorite commissioner, really?
Now he is.
He's been actually for quite a while, but for other reasons as well. But I think the NBA had to do this. And I think it's important we let people know this isn't necessarily a Charlotte thing. This is a North Carolina thing. Charlotte actually wanted to do the right thing for the LGBT community. But unfortunately, the state was not on the same page as the city. I think that's really important that we mm-hmm. make note.
They're really paying the consequences for other people's mentality.
Do you know what the consequences are? This would have brought in $100 million.
That's right.
$100 million to
hit
the
him
city.
What it hurts.
Exactly. So, but I think the NBA needed to do this. Listen, the legislation that they had the opportunity to change. They had the opportunity to right this ship, because I think we're all in agreement here that this is the wrong decision to make, and they didn't do it. So now they're suffering the consequences, and it's sad because, again, Charlotte, the city of Charlotte, I've been there. I love the city. It's a great city, great people. They're very welcoming to the gay community. But unfortunately, this is a North Carolina thing, and it's sad. It's very sad, but I think great decision by the NBA and great decision by Adam Silver. I love the man. I love him.
I think it's amazing the fact that they actually did something about it. There's all these threats. I mean, we know, and I was just looking this up, in 1993, the NFL moved the Super Bowl at that time because Arizona refused to make Martin Luther King an official holiday, and it got moved to Los Angeles, who was the runner-up city. But they lived up to that. But the NFL, there have been some controversial LGBT laws that happened in Houston. It happened in Glendale, in Arizona, and they threatened to take away the Super Bowl, and they didn't. And I was just speaking, and I want to get a quote out there from my colleague, Christina Carl, who is a transgender MLB editor here and writer at ESPN.com, and she was a former member of GLAAD, former board member, and in the advisory board of the Trans Life Center in Chicago. And she said, it's not surprising that the NBA is doing this. And she's just very proud that the NBA, because it's not a PR stunt, they could have played the card that this happened too late. But it shows the commitment. They didn't just make threats. And the fact that they're doing a real commitment and issues, unlike MLB at one point with the very controversial immigration rules in Arizona, and they still held the mm-hmm. All-Star game there. So I think it's very commendable. And yes, Adam Silver, go Adam Silver.
I think Adam Silver took a stand that was necessary. I think the NBA, for all the reasons that we know, high profile, great people that obviously are in contact with minorities, and it's part of diversity. The NBA really represents what the community is really standing for. And at this point in time, I really feel bad for the city because, like Anita, Charlotte is a great town, college town, lots of sports. They really love their sports. They really love everybody. They're so welcoming and they're so warm, you know. Southern attitude is the best. And unfortunately, they're getting punished for an attitude that is so antiquated, completely out of sorts for this 21st century. Let's just think about this. This is part of our community. It's been part of our community. I'm glad they have a voice now. The LGBT community obviously has a strong representation, and they should have the same rights. And at this point in time, the rest of America should be able to just embrace it, live with it. It's part of us.
And I hope this hurts them in terms of, we know it's going to in terms of their pockets. You said, what was it, $100 million
that the All-Star game could have brought into the city of
this
of Charlotte.
Potentially could impact some change or open some minds.
And to Charlotte or the state itself, because it obviously will trickle into the economy of the state, right? Or is just the city?
No, just the city of Charlotte itself. But also, I mean, listen, we are in a tense political climate right now. As we know, the election is just a few months away. And for the NBA to make this stand at this point in time, I really think speaks volumes. Now, this is what I'm going to be paying attention to. Who follows suit? Keep in mind, you have a PGA event that's happening there in 2017, as well as a sprint race car cup race that is going to be happening there in 2017.
What about the NFL?
So this is, it's true. What does the NFL do? The Carolina Panthers. So I'm it's not like they're going to take the Panthers out of Charlotte. But, but nonetheless, I'm curious. Like, you know, this, I think this sets a precedent. Mm-hmm. And I'm really, really curious, what is to follow here in the footsteps of the decision that the NBA has made?
Well, in the case of in 1993, eventually, obviously, you know, Arizona eventually recognized, right, Martin Luther King Day as official. And the NBA is giving Charlotte a chance. They're telling you, right? It was very clear that they said,
rectify.
We hope to reschedule. Mm-hmm. So this is a call on the lawmakers in Charlotte to say, we are not going to sanction discrimination. HB2, this law, the public facilities law, I believe it's the official name for it. We're not going to sanction discrimination against people. Obviously, we don't have that many NBA on the male side in the NBA. Players who have admitted or, you know, come out of the closet, if we're going to use that expression. But it has happened a lot more in the WNBA. And I like that you're saying not only you're not going to discriminate against your audience, you're not going to discriminate against your athletes. And it's really because the athletes are part of the community. Mm-hmm. And it's a beautiful thing. I'm just so proud that the NBA is taking the stand. You know what? Backing it up. Saying, like, you know, stop the threats like MLB did at one point. Oh, yeah, if you guys don't fix those controversial immigration laws, we won't have the All-Star game. But the All-Star game was there.
I'm pretty sure there were conversations before this happened, and I'm pretty sure the state just said, you know what, this is just a game. There's a point in
but
time.
But they gave him a chance.
That's what I'm saying.
They gave him so many chances.
And to think that somebody would be so steadfast in that position to say, we're not changing.
That's it.
We're not budging. This is the scary part. The fact that, yes, they're being given a chance. We're waiting till 2019 and see if it does happen. But they did not budge. So, in essence, they're saying, we really don't care.
Obviously, there's a lot of angst and social unrest in our country right now for a myriad of reasons. But I'd love to see the NBA now in terms of, I don't know what they're planning for the next city, but maybe put it in a city like a Louisiana that's recently suffered some tragedy and take it a step further to shedding light on that. Where would you guys like to see the game played?
Oh, that's an interesting question. Well,
New York, obviously. I mean, go on.
I don't know.
I would say Orlando.
I have to say we had the All-Star game in New York.
I would say Orlando.
I would be with you on Orlando, the tragedy that just happened in Orlando. And it would be so beautiful and an extension of what they did for the Pride, you know, for the hashtag with the Pride community.
Yeah, I'm getting goosebumps.
And, and love is love. I would like to see those hashtags, love is love.
Also, I know we're giving Adam Silver a lot of credit here, mm-hmm, in regard to this, but let's keep in mind, Adam Silver does work for the NBA owners.
Yes.
So, and obviously, I'm sure they had a big say in this decision. I mean, this isn't just Adam Silver making the decision, so let's
get... But he's giving face. He's giving
face. He is the face of the ownership.
But what I'm saying
is let's give the NBA owners some credit here as well.
So let's share the love with them too.
That's what I'm saying. Just give them a little shout out.
Interesting that you mentioned that. You know, there's athletes nowadays that are a lot more comfortable coming out of the closet and, you know, sharing their experience with others. But you got to understand, I don't think there's a family in America that is not touched in one way or another by that community. I mean, we're all involved in one way or another. We have a friend, we have a cousin, a sister, a brother, whatever. Because they're part of us. Mm-hmm. So the fact that there is still a state that is willing to say, we will not accommodate you, we will not function with you, mm-hmm, we are going to keep you aside no matter who you are, what you do. I mean, that's really sad. And the fact that the NBA is taking the stance, I want to see the NFL, I want to see Major League Baseball, you know, do it in their own way, but follow up just because it touches everybody.
And talking about people who have, you know, I love the words, and I'm going to read what Jason Collins said, and I just, it was so special. He said, as a member of the NBA family and as a gay man, I'm extremely proud to see the NBA take initiative and move the All-Star game from North Carolina. Their decision is extremely poignant. And it shows that discrimination of any kind is not welcome in sports or anywhere. I mean, no one can say it better. Mm-hmm. NBA has set the best kind of example.
True.
And we hope that it really is an example. It is not just empty words. They lived up to what they said they were going to do. Hopefully, all of us can do that with our lives, too. We live up to live to that standard. When something doesn't meet, when something just doesn't feel right, to not conform. Why should we? Why should we shut up? In, you know, when facing discrimination, why shouldn't we take a stand when we see our brothers and sisters? I proudly have my best girlfriend who is gay. And you just sit there and I go, I'm going to stand up for my sister. I'm going to stand up for my brother, for my friends. Mm-hmm. That's what Adam Silver did. And I'm just, this just beautiful words by Jason Collins.
Of course. So we're all applauding the NBA, the owners, the whole organization here, and the players who have also been coming out and taking a stand on a lot of different issues. As for the WNBA, they tried to take a stand and they didn't receive the same support here. In response to the WNBA fining players from the Fever, Liberty, and Mercury for wearing black warm-up shirts in the wake of recent shootings by and against police officers, the Fever had a media blackout after Thursday's game where they only answered questions surrounding the Black Lives Matters movement. Now, Carmelo Anthony supported the players, saying this: a bunch of teams did it and individuals did it. Everybody has their own freedom of speech if they decide to use the platform to do that. I don't see any reasons for anybody to get fined. We did it. The NBA did it 2 years ago. The NBA was very supportive. I don't see why it would be different this time around. Marley?
Well, the word is double standard. It's the definition of it, right? Like when we sit down, 2014, Chloe and I were discussing this before we got on the air. You remember the LeBron James, the Kyrie Irving?
I can't breathe black
shirts. The Brooklyn Nets did it too, because obviously it happened in New York. And in the wake of the death of Eric Gardner, the unarmed black man who was shot down in New York City, and then the players were not fined. Now, the league says, well, the uniform rules and the guidelines were issued afterwards, after the shirts were worn. Not only that, the WNBA actually compromised and said, not only will we wear, you know, these shirts, we will wear Adidas shirts. So we actually meet your standard that I'm actually going to wear the sanctioned, you know, like brand of the league, and they still. So, I mean, the double standard extends to coverage. It extends to media attention. We know that coverage on male athletes and salary, the coverage on male athletes is always focused on skills and performance. You know, but with women, it has to do with your off field or maybe your appearance. We know that.
Not a maybe.
The media.
It's not a maybe.
It happened in this panel when we sat here. They don't discuss a lot of people on social media. They don't discuss your knowledge. They don't discuss your knowledge. They discuss what we look like. This has nothing to do. This is about knowledge. These women are standing up there for something they believe in, and they're fined for it. It's incredible. Talk about it. The definition of a double standard.
It's interesting because they're actually falling back on a clause, and we mentioned this yesterday, a uniform clause. And, you know, you could say and you could argue, yes, maybe there are certain rules that need to be followed because they are part of a team. They do belong to a team, so basically there is a uniform. But in reality, they were not wearing a uniform. It was a warm-up session. Second, the clause is not readily available. Where is it? So where is the rule?
We demand the clause.
Yes. You know, you cannot break a rule that's not there. So it's really imposing something that is not obviously written. There's not a line to be crossed because there is no line. So, and again, why is it okay for all these high-profile NBA players and for these girls who are taking a major stance and taking a risk because obviously they know. They knew about it. They had to know.
I mean, you asked the question, and the answer is it's not okay.
No.
It's really not. And it's on a number of levels, and you guys have pointed them out. It seems to me like NBA players can make that stand, that whether it's clothing or whether it's standing up at the ESPYs or whether it's the NBA itself saying, okay, we're not going to have our All-Star game in Charlotte. I just feel like the NBA itself is so far more advanced and aggressive in standing up for certain social issues. Mm-hmm. And when women in the WNBA want to do it, they get fined and they get punished. It is a double standard and it's unacceptable. And I hope, you know, I wonder if there's some WNBA players out there that are a little reluctant to stand up and speak like we are right now, because they're possibly worried about
retaliation.
They're worried about getting fined or what have you. But I would imagine that there's a number of WNBA players possibly maybe watching this show right now that feel exactly the way we do and would like to voice their opinion the way we are right now, but might be a little frightened to do it. And you know what? That's sad.
That's why I admire what Tamika Catchings did. She just stood out there in front of the cameras and she said, no matter where our success is on the court, basketball is just basketball.
Exactly.
There is a world outside and it's more important than what we do, which is basketball. For a player of this level, a WNBA player, a professional, top in her league, to say what's happening outside is more important than what I live my life for, good for you. Good for you for standing out there and saying, because all of a sudden, because you're a professional athlete, doesn't mean that you're not a member of society.
Yeah.
You don't have, right? Like, you're supposed to.
And these issues don't touch you and your families and your community. The other thing that I love, too, they're fine for wearing the warm-ups, and then they take it a step further and bring it into the interview rooms and showing that they're not going to stop and they're not going to be stopped by and only answering questions specifically on the Black Lives Matter movement. So clearly, the fines didn't shut them up. And then to have Carmelo Anthony come out, I think we're going to see some type of statement and something come out. And I think there might be a little bit of a changing of the guard there with the WNBA. When you're looking now, the response that everybody's getting in terms of their findings and how the NBA was supported, I think they're going to have to change their tune a little bit.
Well, they have to. Like, at this point, it's getting, and the good thing about this is to put in some attention on the WNBA. Maybe it's the negative attention, but I am so glad we're talking.
But look, they're not in trouble. So that's why we should.
No, when I mean negative attention, I just don't mean that they're not being recognized for their skills.
Of course, that's all I mean.
Yep. You know, it doesn't mean anything that this is a negative subject. Mm-hmm. It's a very positive subject that athletes are taking a social stand. Mm-hmm. I just mean, like, I would like to be sitting here and talking about their skills.
I just would like to bring it all together. It's interesting to see how the NBA has taken such a strong stance regarding that rule in North Carolina. So somewhere, someone is going to have to raise their hand and say, if we're standing for this, we got to stand for this too. Mm-hmm. So,
well, we have to be careful when we do that, because, and just because of semantics and because of legality, right? Because a lot of the issues that have happened with certain killings of unarmed black men, they're not necessarily, no one has been found guilty of something. What is happening in North Carolina is against the law.
I understand.
So then that's why we have to be very careful, because we can make an indictment on people.
No, but I'm not saying crucify anybody. What I'm saying is take a stance and establish your position. Again, you support the girls as part of your league, because the league is supporting exactly a legality of a situation in North Carolina. Mm-hmm. So now support your girls, because they're not doing anything illegal either. I mean, there's a freedom of speech. And even Melo said, we have to come and support these girls because they're doing something right. We did it 2 years ago. Why can't they do it now?
I completely understand what you're saying, and I support them. Their argument is, oh, no, the uniform rules came up.
Hey, again,
right? That's
really?
Their argument. But I do, and really, I'm trying to play devil's advocate here, because I want to be very clear that we're all together in this.
Yeah.
And this is but I understand how the NBA or the WNBA can stand for something that is illegal. It's discriminatory. Again, it's an entire class of people. And the other one, and I'm going to be very careful with this, which is an opinion of what you believe that you should stand for. Even though a lot of unarmed black men are being killed, a lot of people believe that maybe it's not a problem, right? Like, some people, because it's a legality. Now, these girls believe it's a problem, and we should stand with
them.
But
here's the thing. When it was the heat with Trayvon Martin and they wore their hoodies, that's the Black Lives
same
Matter
position.
Movement, and the NBA supported them. So that's why I'm confused here, why there's the divide with the WNBA, because I still look at that as the same issue.
Absolutely.
And I would think that they would be on the same page, and I'm hoping that they work towards that.
Exactly.
That's what we hope. And at least the I Can't Breathe shirts are the exact same thing that these girls are doing right now. There is no reason for these fines. And yesterday, you call for Carmelo to open his wallet.
But he's
spoken up. Now we need him to open his wallet.
That's right. Come on, Melo.
I know you're making that money, Melo.
In fact, we shared the numbers yesterday. And again, for folks who did not tune in yesterday, you guys missed a really great show. But the average salary for a WNBA player is $72,000 per season. The average salary for an NBA player is a little over $6 million.
And the rookies are making over $500,000.
Again, it's taking a hair out of a cat's fur. $500, really?
That's it. Come on, Melo. We believe in you.
Say that in Spanish.
quitarle un pelo a un gato.
Exactly.
Taking a hair out of a...
By the way, I absolutely love this outfit.
There we because go. I'm angelical like that.
Yeah, and I might need to copy on that one. I'm absolutely loving it. When we come back, we're going to switch gears here. You aren't going to believe this, all you Steelers fans. Le'Veon Bell.
Oh, my fantasy.
Facing another suspension. We were so excited to see you carrying the rock. You won't
stay
fly. We will
the week.
Steelers running back Le'Veon Bell is facing a 4-game suspension for violation of the NFL's drug policy, sources telling our Dan Graziano. But this time, not for a failed drug test, but a missed drug test. Bell's appeal is expected to be heard before the season. Bell was suspended in 2015 for a violation of the policy on substances of abuse after he was arrested for marijuana possessions and DUI in the summer of 2014. Anita?
Well, let's set this up where this dude went wrong from the beginning. The NFL has a timeline, a calendar. They tell you when you're going to be tested for marijuana.
So you get a heads up.
So you get a heads up. You know.
Yeah.
You know when you're going to have to pee in a cup.
Yep.
Okay? So do the timeline. And I'm sorry, if you can't, as Stephen A. likes to say in Spanish...
Dile que no a la marihuana.
No,
dile
bájate,
que no.
Bájate.
Dile que no.
Stay off the weed.
Stay off the weed. For that period of time where you know that you're going to be tested and
much
potentially...
Much sexier in Spanish. No disrespect to Stephen A., but yes.
Dile que no a la marihuana, Stephen A., practice.
There you go. So, and once you fail, then... all is out the window. Then your life is just, you never know when you're going to get tested. They could show up, knock on your door. I want to say it was funny. I think Kirk Cousins was vacationing with his grandmother. Mm-hmm. And they came to his vacation home with his grandmother. I mean, so you never know. So number one, this is where, like, I understand players like to smoke weed.
Yeah.
It's fine. All the power to you, man. But no, but understand the calendar. The NFL is giving you opportunity. And the NFL is giving you an opportunity to... not smoke for a period of time, so you know when not to get caught. So
this was for the first suspension.
Right.
He knew exactly when he was going to get tested.
So
this is the first time around. Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so then he had DUI and marijuana. Mm-hmm. So then now he's tested all the time. So
randomly.
Now, right, randomly. So now he missed this test, right? Okay. This is kind of, I mean, and I'm using the analogy here. Tell me if you think I'm wrong, but this is kind of like you get pulled over. Maybe you've had one too many. You're not drunk, but you know that if you blow in that breathalyzer...
Yeah.
You know that
you know,
it's going to
You know you're getting into deep.
You know, you're
yeah, absolutely.
You're in the pen.
Yeah.
You blow into that.
No, of course not.
And this is my opinion.
You don't blow. Well, he did blow, but so that's what he did.
He's a lucky man.
If he missed this
Let's call it he avoided the test.
If you know that you were going to fail a drug test in the NFL, and God knows, as we know, what jury and executioner, right?
Yeah. Exactly.
Roger Goodell. Who, and could have possibly been suspended for the entire season. Would you take, if you knew you wouldn't pass it?
So it's already established that...
And again, this is all assumption.
Mm-hmm.
This is all assumption.
Okay,
so worst case scenario, if he would have tested positive, we wouldn't have known how long the suspension would have been. It would have been just Goodell's decision. Now, he didn't take the test, so we're looking at a 4-day suspension.
We don't know yet.
Well, the thing is,
we're looking at a 4-game suspension.
I mean,
right
he
now.
Is, yes. He is going to appeal. We know that.
Of course,
just
and then it's going to be.
It happened last year with the 3 suspension that went to 2 and all this stuff. But come on, I mean, I kind of get it. Like, you go, I'm going to avoid what, miss? We really want to call, like, avoided the test.
It's a calculated risk.
There we go.
Yeah.
And he is going to win by this calculated risk. So
of
maybe
course.
Is it time to address the policy? Is it time to put a policy in place that is just like Major League Baseball, where you're not told, you're tested randomly, and you have a set amount of games that you get to
My question is, why are these guys even tested at all?
I was just going to say that.
I mean, it's legal in certain states now.
Yeah.
Like, why?
Why
are these guys even tested at all for marijuana?
Whether people smoke weed or not, that's a whole other issue. That's their business, whether it's legalized.
Mm-hmm.
But just from a football perspective, as a football fan, I've been in for the Steelers specifically, he's dealt with a lot of injuries.
Yep.
He had some other issues. So I'm saying, like, dude, come on, get it together. We're so excited. They could have a fantastic year this season, having all these their pieces back healthy again. I know they've lost Martavis Bryant, and Heath Miller's not there anymore. But this team's loaded and ready to go, and this hurts them tremendously. So as far as the teammates, this is the rule. So you gotta have your stuff together.
Well, keep in mind, D'Angelo Williams stepped in for him last year. I've got some stats.
He did a great job.
Yeah, 200 carries, 907 yards, 11 touchdowns, 40 receptions was a big part of the rush, the passing attack, 367 yards. Mm-hmm. So I you know, is this a huge hit? Yes, because Le'Veon Bell is such an immense talent.
Yeah.
And not only in the rushing attack, but in the passing game as well.
And he hasn't been there.
Coming off of MCL and PCL mm-hmm. tear in his knee. So was he going to be worked in slowly? Probably. But yes, this is a huge loss. If it's just, hopefully it's just four games, if not less, for the Pittsburgh Steelers. But I still don't think that they're, I'm not looking at the first four games. Let's say hypothetically mm-hmm. speaking, if he's suspended, I'm not looking at the first four games and going, oh man, like they're going to loot, like the J.J. Watt situation that I know we're going to get into a little later on the show. I'm looking at that and going, wow, my feeling about the Texans is a little different now. You're talking about a disc. He's an impact player, but there's you hit the nail on the head, Molly. There's such great talent on that team that I don't think they're going
to. It's going to be such an impact.
So you don't think it matters? They're not going to miss that much of a beat.
I'm going to go with, you know what? It hurts. Let's talk about what really, really matters here. My fantasy team. This is what's really important. He killed me last year. I came
and he's going to kill you again.
And he is going, really, Le'Veon? Dile que no a la marijuana. You are ruining my league. This is ridiculous. Yeah. Again,
stay off the pot.
Stay off the pot. Stay
off the pot.
Stay off the pot.
Really, at this point, I understand and I agree. You know, at this point in time, we all know we can't be a hypocrite about it. We just can't cover the sun with a finger. It's that simple. But a rule is a rule. I understand where you're...
That's what I mean. It's not whether people want to blow or smoke weed, whatever the heck they want to do. That's their business. I get it. And the issue of whether it should be legalized, and we talked about it. We had Eugene Monroe on Mike and Mike earlier, and he talked about retiring early and how he would rather do that than
take painkillers. And he was a strong advocate,
which are highly addictive. So I'm not saying either way being moral police here.
Yes.
But this is the rule. This guy is so good. He is a beast. He is so talented. Why put your team in this position? This is the rule. Whether we like it or not, there's a lot of rules that we have to deal with that we don't like. So don't do this. And I get that it's four games, but come on.
You know what's amazing
we're missing a huge point. Somebody is not doing their homework. We all know there's a babysitter in every single locker room. Somebody's not doing their homework.
Yeah, but he's
24.
It doesn't matter.
Why are you guys trying to give a task, though?
Listen.
Amazing.
He's only 24 years old.
Yeah, and he's
like, and he is ruining the best years of his career. This is an outstanding back, keeper league. Outstanding back. Outstanding.
Claudia.
24 years old. He keeps ruining this.
I've covered the NFL for many, many years. There is no babysitter.
You know what I mean. There's always somebody looking over your shoulder, trying to keep you straight, trying to keep you in line. I'm not saying that there's somebody that gets paid to just watch you.
You're not fazed by this at all.
You covered the NFL for a long time,
yes,
too. You know, it doesn't matter. A team can assign. Didn't Jerry Jones and the Dallas Cowboys do that with Des Bryant at some point?
Yeah, I mean, that's
right?
Happened for many years.
And that happened with the Cowboys. That's what I'm saying.
I mean, there's always this one leader in the team that's going to have this come to Jesus conversation.
But you can be smarter about it. Anita, they can even be smarter about it. You said when you know you're getting figure out the loopholes. It's like, come on, be on point.
First and foremost, that's my point. Like, if you're going to smoke weed and you're an NFL player, like, all the power to you, just, like, be smart about it.
Well,
right? When you're going to get tested, and just, like, you know, like, suck it up for, like, a few months.
I remember.
And stay off the weed.
But maybe he can't time it. Maybe he can't add. Like, he can't figure it out.
You know, somebody said to
I'm giving the benefit of the doubt to everybody.
You know, maybe in terms of how long it's going to stay in his
maybe
system.
He doesn't know how to use Google Calendar in his phone.
Said to me, there's nothing wrong, it's just poorly executed.
It's not only poorly executed, it's that you believe you're above the law, right? So he's going to think, this is one of the things about being a great athlete, right? They all think, it's not going to happen to me.
But my personal opinion, and I'm curious to get yours as well, and my personal opinion is I don't think these players should be tested for marijuana. I really don't. I just don't.
I think if it's illegal, you should be tested. I think when a substance is illegal, you should continue to be tested. I think it needs to be approached in a wider level. When marijuana is legal everywhere, then you can use it. It's the same thing as alcohol. And I do think that drugs of abuse affect performance.
Claudia?
In excess.
That's a touchy subject specifically because it's so different from one state to the next. So now we're starting to figure, you know, morally, I mean, there's a lot of people out there that might not agree. And so we go back to what's right in California, what's right in Colorado, what's not right in Florida. So now we start playing with a whole different issue. But the league is a league. And we go back to what Molly said, a rule is a rule. And we're dealing with grown men. Again, be on point. There's nothing wrong, just poorly executed.
But as far as marijuana, this is where it gets tricky for me. It's tough, and I'd have to ask a medical expert, and I'm sure doctors would have varying opinions on this, but these painkillers are highly addictive.
Yes.
Yeah.
And that's very scary as well. And we're seeing what's happening, and obviously all the scary things with CT, et cetera, and these guys are putting their bodies on the line, and that's why we're seeing so many people retiring. I think younger, they're able to make a little more money so they can, and they don't want to beat up their bodies, and also then the concussion issues as well. But I don't know. I mean, when people are saying, oh, marijuana is a gateway drug or whatever, stay away from it, it's also very scary taking all these painkillers as well. So that's when I would defer to a medical expert here. I don't know if marijuana is a better answer, and I know a lot of players feel more comfortable because they're considering it more natural. I can't really answer your question, but I think it's certainly up for debate. But I would just need more like medical research on what's the answer there.
And then we go, what's the right thing, to follow the medical advice or to follow the morals? Remember, we're dealing with people from completely different environments, social economical status, with completely different backgrounds. So again, what's more important, the medical value or the morality behind it? It's a very complicated issue. And again, that's why the NFL has that rule.
But the thing is that when Molly was mentioning, and it's interesting that you mentioned the painkillers, because obviously painkillers are legal, right?
Yes.
But a lot of people consider some members of the medical profession prescribe them liberally.
And they get abused.
And it is. So these are legal, drugs of abuse. And it's just very interesting. But to Anita's point, I think it requires a greater conversation. Mm-hmm. I completely see your point of what you think. Yeah, why not? This is an option for them that may be safer than other things. But my point is, because when we get into legality, it gets tricky. So if it's something that is illegal in a particular place, then it should be illegal in every performance.
It's
illegal at ESPN. As I said, we get tested. It's illegal to be because marijuana is an illegal drug. So you're not allowed to be an employee of the Walt Disney Company because if you use illegal
drugs. Not every company tests their employees.
No, I understand that.
They don't.
There
are some companies that do not test their employees.
No, absolutely. And it's their prerogative.
Right. What I'm saying is that I think the NFL's prerogative should be stop testing.
Your gut, ladies, and I know this is hard to do, but say 15 years from now, do you think they're going to be testing for it?
No.
I don't think so either.
No. I don't think so.
I don't know.
Not if these conversations continue to happen, hopefully.
Yeah. No, and again, with a lot of research, like you were talking about, in terms of the effects of concussions, headaches, I mean, we are to this day finding more and more value to the use of pot, moreover than just to get high. I mean, there's a lot of value. A lot of cancer patients use it. A lot of people with seizures use it. So there's going to be a moment where they would rather use that than use Percocet, Vicodin. And we all know the secondary effects of that. And like you said, those are legal and those are highly addictive.
Yeah.
And I know of a lot of people that have gone to rehab, and it's a lot harder to wean off those substances than to get rid of pot.
I just think that you can't, there comes a point, and I don't want to be like the square one on the table who doesn't want to legalize marijuana. It's not the point about that. But I don't think that
you
can put a big square on my face. I'm okay with that. You know what? I've never been cool a day in my life, so I'm okay
with
that.
You are cool.
Okay, that. But my point here is marijuana affects your cognitive process. Yeah. It affects the way you develop. I do not want a 325-pound man running towards me. Hi, I don't. I'm sorry. Do you want it? I'm sorry, I don't.
You know what?
I'm sorry.
Somewhere, that sounded like a good fantasy. I have to.
Wears white.
And I think you're a lot of fun. I just have an inkling that you're a lot of fun. Up next, we have more NFL news to get into. This is a huge hit, potentially, for the Texans. Things looked on the up and up. Obviously, they got their new quarterback. And then it appears J.J. Watt will start the season on the PUP list. We'll give you the latest and see how this will affect them starting off the season. We're First Take next. For the second time, time in the last 6 months, J.J. Watt had back surgery. The Texans are optimistic that Watt will be ready to play at the start of the season. So don't panic there. He's on the PUP list just for the preseason. But sources told ESPN that there is some concern about his availability for the early part of the season there. Sources told our Tanya Ganguly that Watt had a surgery for a disc issue. Anita, things were looking optimistic for this team. On a scale of 1 to 10, how concerned are you for the Texans if he has to miss regular season games?
Pretty concerned. If I had to give you a number, probably a 7, because we're talking about a disc. I mean, that's pretty serious. Now, let's really break this down. When you look around the NFL and you look at the teams and you remove a quarterback from a team, right? You can say for the majority of the teams, wow, that team is going to take a dip. The team's not going to be the same. But it's typically at the quarterback position. J.J. Watt is one of the few defensive players that I think you can put in that category where you look, this Texans team, they are defined by their defense. He is a man possessed. He is not from this planet. We use this word this season, hashtag otherworldly. That's the type of defensive player he is. 17 and a half sacks last year. 74 and a half, I believe, in his career. The loss of J.J. Watt, and granted, he could be ready to go week one, he could be ready to go week three, who knows? But considering that this is a back issue, I have some big concerns because without J.J. Watt on that Houston Texans team, this team is very, very different. And this is a team, let's keep this in mind, they went out, they spent a lot of money on the offensive side of the ball, they bring in Brock Osweiler from Denver. I love offensively what they're doing. They bring in Lamar Miller from the Miami Dolphins.
Yeah.
Mama, we lost him.
Yeah.
So, offensively, finally, this is a year going into the season, right, that the offense can at least kind of be on the same scale as the defense in some regard and put up some points and really be a dangerous threat as threat is for the defensive side of the ball. But without J.J. Watt, Clowney hasn't proven himself.
Mm-hmm.
First-round draft pick, he needs to prove himself this year. That's still kind of, in question. So this, he is the face of this franchise. He defines this franchise. Mm-hmm. He wins football games for this franchise. And if this back situation is more serious, and we don't know if it is or not.
We don't even have any details on it.
I'm excited about the Texans season with a healthy J.J. Watt. I think they will really compete and make this division fun. But without J.J. Watt, I have some major concerns. I'd give you a 7, Molly, to answer your question.
It's funny because when I hear herniated disc, the most recent news in MLB obviously has been Clayton Kershaw and the fact that he may or may not need surgery. Everything is just kind of, so the Dodgers with their $215 million pitcher on the line and maybe their season on the brink. That's exactly what I think of about J.J. Watt. He's that figure, right? He's the ace of that team. Mm-hmm. And I don't see them competing. I'm going to go with 10. I mean, herniated disc, we're talking about, I can think of, and just because my NFL days are a little bit behind me, but I can think of David Wright, who is probably going to miss the rest of the season for the New York Mets. I can think of Nick Markakis, was never the same. So these are this is spine fusion. We actually know what some other players have been able to accomplish, with spine fusion surgery, but you don't know the extent. So let's focus on the extent. That's going to be very scary for the Texans. J.J. Watt, he's a difference maker.
And
that's
I want to say, this is his second, right? His second,
and second in a year.
Yeah.
And then he also had groin surgery. We're talking about a man who's been torn up. We're talking about a man who's used to be playing injured, hurt. This is a man that has pushed the envelope for so long. So I'm concerned at a 10, like you. Not just because J.J. Watt is pretty much the one established player for the Texans, but this is the guy that has carried emotionally, mentally, the team for a long time. And if he's not there, obviously the performance of the team is going to go down. But if he is there, then we're talking about a career that could have spanned throughout, 12, 15 years to a career that's going to be cut short. So I'm not just concerned about the Texans. I'm also concerned about J.J. Watt. I'm concerned about his well-being, his health, because that's an exciting player to watch. I love to see him play. What's going to happen if he does come back? 2 back surgeries in a year, groin surgery, multiple muscles being repaired. This is not the same guy that we had a few years back.
Now, very interesting, because you hit the nail on the head. This is a player who plays hurt and injured. It's very hard to find players in the NFL. Obviously, it's difficult for you to play injured. A lot of players don't even like to play when they're hurt.
Yeah.
J.J. Watt, he does both. And just to kind of compare, I mean, we saw what happened with Steph Curry, right, in Golden State. At what point in time Is it going to come to a head? Because you saw him in that Kansas City playoff game. He didn't want to come out. He didn't want to come out. Is this going to be a difficult situation? This is another thing to be concerned about is, will he be ready, truly ready, to play in a safe regard so that it won't affect him? Because you know his passion to play. He wants to be on the football field. I mean, he lives, eats, breathes, sleeps football, sort of like myself. And so at what point in time, you know, it's got to be difficult for a team to step in and say, dude, you're not ready. And will they say that? I mean,
they need him.
There's just a lot of things that a road that this could go down.
The fact that he had a torn core muscle, when we heard about that he played, I wonder how much that contributed to this other injury, right? Because you kind of think about it, a herniated disc in your back usually means that you're not supporting the rest of your body.
Body compensates.
It doesn't. So it's really interesting that he may have, obviously I'm not a doctor, that's as you guys well know, I'm very far from being a doctor. But the point being that this is, it's just really interesting, and I just, for him to require surgery, it had to get to
and to admit to the fact that he needed surgery.
It's time.
Yeah.
Well, it probably wasn't a choice at that point.
I think a little step further on this team though. So in terms of Brock Osweiler obviously coming over, Lamar Miller, if we're going to talk about our fantasy teams, he's disappointed me on mine quite a bit. So coming over. So you're confident in Brock Osweiler and Lamar Miller. Let's pretend they are healthy. You're liking this team?
I am. I am. I'm liking it a lot. I love DeAndre Hopkins. Mm-hmm. I think he's really sensational. And it's amazing to me the numbers that Hopkins has been able to put up without a good, solid quarterback. And the one thing I do like about Osweiler is he's got a big arm. And one thing about Hopkins is he can stretch the field. He just hasn't had a quarterback to get him the football. And he finally does. Now, the biggest knock on Brock is his accuracy. So, but when you've got a talent as athletic as Hopkins, chase that ball down, dude. Chase it down. So, also, they draft Will Fuller. I think he's going to complement the wide receiving core a lot. And you mentioned Lamar Miller. You know, it's interesting to me. I just don't, if you saw the way that the Miami Dolphins underutilized Lamar Miller last year, finally they turned it around. They did start using him. And actually, the Dolphins started winning at that point. I feel that his skill set was not totally tapped into with the Miami Dolphins. And I do believe that we're going to see it this season with the Houston Texans. They've got a lot of talent. They drafted well. They've got a lot of athleticism. I love what they've done on the offensive side of the ball. And if J.J. Watt cannot play, if he cannot play 1, 2, 3, 4 games, whatever the case may be, it's sad to me. Because I think there's a lot of excitement about this team that finally the offense has caught up with the defense in some regard.
But Brian Cushing is supposedly healthy. Jadeveon Clowney, I mean, I covered him in camp with his rookie year. He was a real special talent. Doesn't this give them an opportunity now to step up in the meantime?
Mm-hmm.
They have
it's called for
on the defense. I know it's not J.J. Watt.
I just don't know. I mean, Osweiler has started. Osweiler has started 7 games in his 4 years in the NFL. I don't know that he deserves all this praise, and they all happened last year. So I don't know that it's really going to happen. I mean, I'm with you with DeAndre Hopkins. What he did was spectacular, over 1,500 yards and all this stuff. But, I mean, why?
You're saying the seven game, that
isn't
it's such a small
wasn't
sample
enough.
Size. You're saying it's a really small sample size for me to be as thrilled as I am. What I'm,
yes.
What I'm, what, this is what I,
thank
this
you
is,
for actually distilling what I was going to say, because I made no sense.
No, you did.
I appreciate it.
We haven't seen enough from him.
No, it's fair. That's fair.
Okay.
That's fair. What I'm saying is I'm excited about the potential.
There we go.
I'm not sitting here telling you he's going to pass for 5,000 yards and 40 touchdowns. No, that's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is, you haven't had a quarterback with his skill set at that position on this offense in quite a while. And also, the talent that's around him is really fast. It's really athletic. If he can just play smart football on top of the fact that he's got there's very few quarterbacks in the NFL that got big arms that can actually toss a football 90 yards. There's not that many, believe it or not. And he has the ability to do that. And when you have a quarterback that can do that, and you match him up with a wide receiver that is just a burner, there could be some fun 75-85 yard touchdowns that can be scored this season.
I think he's going to disappoint us just like Stafford did.
Oh,
you're a party pooper.
Sorry. I know.
We gotta be optimistic.
I say no to marijuana. Really.
No, but you know what? The way I see it, this is a good opportunity for everybody to shine, because we're so used to that one name that follows the Texans. All of a sudden, we have an opportunity, like you just said, to see all these guys that have great skill set, They're very athletic, and they have to be at this point in time, due to the division and how competitive it is. Yeah, it's a call for action, literally.
They haven't done it. Last point.
Relax.
You mentioned Clowney. You're right. This is an opportunity for Clowney. And let me tell you something. This is a guy, I don't know how he can't inside be burning inside, wanting to prove why he deserved to be drafted as high as he was. So this is a huge opportunity for him. I'd like to see him kind of grab that brass ring.
He's got to stay healthy, of course, too.
Yeah.
And that was part of the issue going into it. Watt, of course, does it on offense, too. 5 touchdowns last season, 3 of them on offense in 2014. And the other thing that I wanted to mention, too, is we talked about coaching trees yesterday. Bill O'Brien is part of the Bill Belichick coaching tree, and I think he's going to do a fantastic job coaching up this team and continue to build on that success that they started with last season.
Absolutely.
We will leave it. The Court of Arbitration for Sport on Thursday rejected Russia's appeal on the ban of the country's track and field athletes at the Olympics. The world's fastest man, Usain Bolt, said he backed the decision to ban Russia's track and field athletes. The IOC can still determine whether to accept individual athletes either as Russian representatives or neutral athletes. Claudia, I want to start with you here. What's your reaction?
It's way overdue. Let's talk about this. This has been going on forever. Systematic doping, not only in Russia, many countries. As a matter of fact, I've known athletes very closely as a young athlete myself. They've been trying this since pre-puberty because they are honed to become these amazing athletes. Now, is it late? No, it's about time. Now, is all this testing relevant? Not really. Because they're so far behind. Now, is Russia the only country that should be scrutinized and looked a little closer? No. There's a whole lot of countries that are doing it because, again, it's readily available. The process for doping is so far advanced compared to the process of testing that by the time they catch up, it's already too late. They're already obsolete. Case in point, Tour de France, it took them forever to catch up. Now, is it only track and field? No, let's look at wrestling. Let's look at weightlifting. Let's look at swimming. It's across the board. It's really an epidemic. So at this point in time, I feel really bad for these guys that were actually clean or tested clean because, you know, we still need to know all those sample Bs that were never opened because the scandal is not only that they tested positive, is that protocol was not followed.
Mm-hmm.
And across the board, I know firsthand, I've seen it. Children at the age of 9, 10, being taken through hormone processes.
That young?
Yes. So gymnasts. And it's a process. It doesn't start when you're at the high end, at the ultimate level of athleticism. It starts at a very young age. Specifically, gymnastics is one of those sports in certain countries where they do not want those girls to grow up, develop breasts. So they inject them with hormones in order to maintain them at a certain size, at a certain weight.
Makes my stomach turn.
This is not new. This is definitely not new. Now, did the IOC finally open their eyes and say, okay, we got to do something about it? Is Russia being used as an example? Absolutely. Is it fair? No. But again, you got to start somewhere.
It is so sad.
It is.
I just feel like the fact that this is happening. And, you know, we were getting some names from our researcher, David Sabino, and he told me that at this point, 2 Russian track and field athletes have been cleared to compete in Rio. Their names are Daria Klishina, and who is a long jumper, and Yulia Stepanova, who is a middle distance runner. And I think the sad part about this is that it breaks the Olympic dreams of other people. It's happened before because of political unrest that a lot of unaffiliated athletes have competed at the Olympics. And what breaks my heart in the terms of the IOC, the International Olympic Committee, is that they've been hiding this for so long, and not all of a sudden you grow a conscience. That's the part. But my admiration of the IOC, it's kind of weird, right? Puerto Rico, being a territory of the United States, is usually not allowed to compete in most international competitions by itself, most of the athletes. But the IOC recognizes Puerto Rico as an individual country, and, you know, Puerto Rico has won medals. So the Olympics for me were so special. It was the only time I got to see athletes from Puerto Rico carry a flag instead of doing it under the flag of the United States. So that was interesting. So to see the IOC, who is a governing body that I sort of have a very, very soft spot for, all of a sudden growing a conscience, it seems a little bit disingenuous to me. Like you said, Claudia, it's happened for so long. Now we're going to care. So I know those comments from some of them who are, you know, from some Russian members of the Olympic Committee are saying, this is politically motivated. This is just not true. Like, why are you guys doing this? And I love it. They called it, thank you very much, everyone, for the funeral of athletics. Like, this is the, this is what this, the Russia sports minister, and actually Yelena Isinbayeva, a two-time Olympic pole vault champion, said that. They called the IOC, but I do think that they're being a little bit hypocritical. Just a little bit.
When you use the word sad, and I think what's sad is you have 68 Russian track and field athletes. Now you only have two that are going to be allowed to compete individually without the affiliation, of course.
So they're not representing Russia.
Right, which I think one of my favorite things in watching, I don't know about you guys, but watching the Olympics is the opening ceremonies and how the countries come out. And the, as you said, the athletes, they're so prideful. They have, they're wearing the flags and their special uniform. It's going to be interesting to see how do these two athletes walk out for that opening. That's going to be interesting to me. But you're telling me out of the 68, right? I said 68. Mm-hmm. That they're all doping? Why is it that in one of these, by the way, Yulia Stepanova, okay, she's the whistleblower, by the way.
So, and she's allowed to run.
Because she was the whistleblower, so okay, she's one of the individuals who are allowed to participate. I don't think it's fair. I find it hard to believe that all 66 remaining Russian track and field athletes are doping. How do you do individual testing now to weed those out? Something has to be done because you've got and keep in mind, we're talking about, understand what it takes to be an Olympic athlete, the commitment. Mm-hmm. You talked about gymnastics. I've had several friends that were gymnasts who, like, you live away from your family so that you could be near there are sacrifices that families make, that athletes make for this dream. This isn't like, and we've been talking about it because of, you know, the professional golfers who aren't going to go to Rio, right, because they're afraid of Zika. Well, they still, Spieth, Rory, Day, they're professional golfers. It's much different when you're talking about an athlete who doesn't have that professional kind of stage to perform in, and this is it for them.
Do you think they shouldn't be banned?
So what I'm saying is I'm sure that out of the 66, because now there's two, right? I'm sure out of the other 66, that they're all not doping.
I'm gonna take the Kool-Aid away.
Really?
Yeah, stop the Kool-Aid.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
Isn't that a huge assumption though, Claudia?
It's a fair assumption.
Really? You think that's fair?
It's a fair assumption, and I'm gonna tell you why. Just because there's a whistleblower, she's not clean. Just because she's clean now, it doesn't mean she wasn't participating in the process. I'm telling you right now.
So you're saying that you believe that every single track and field athlete for Russia,
I'd say at least 90%.
Okay, but still.
At least 90%.
So still, all right. So now you've got that 10%.
But now we have two.
Now you've got that 10%.
Those are the ones you're hurting for.
That I am hurting for, because this is a sacrifice.
This is a commitment every year. Yes, and you can,
but this is your life. This is everything. These are dreams. These are people's
dreams. But hang tight. You said something very, very important. They've sacrificed everything, and the sacrifice comes at a cost. And that cost comes with whatever it takes to make it, I am going to do it. And I hate to say it, it's an unwritten rule. If you ain't cheating, you're not trying. The sad part is, I'm not condoning it.
Yeah.
It's just a reality.
That's what it takes.
It's a reality. I come from an era where I remember a 100-meter dash that was being ran in 10, maybe a little bit over 10 seconds. They've shaved off to 9.93, 9.92. I'm sorry, but that doesn't happen naturally. There is no way. Mind you, I've never performed at that level
at all. We can also make a broad assumption that every Olympic athlete is doping. I will not stand for that press.
I understand, but I'm saying those people that do it, and because I have seen what it takes, I've seen the sacrifices, I've seen kids being taken away from their homes, I've seen government systems systematically. Because, again, they are representing the country. It's not even their choice. I'm telling you, 80% of those kids that walk out of the house, they don't have parents overseeing what's
yeah,
going Claudia, on.
Yeah, that's what I wanted to ask you. Did they know? Because I'm still stuck on the fact, and maybe it's my own naivete, hearing that 8 and 9 year old girls. I'm thinking,
oh yeah, no,
my
no.
niece that's staying with me right now, that's that age, and the thought of that. And again, I didn't know that it was happening at that young of an age. And when you're 18 plus, it's your decision, whatever you want to do to the body and the side effects. But I'm just thinking of their development, prepubescent, and all the detriments that can create to them.
Most of them, they have no clue.
So the parents don't know.
The parents don't know, but again.
Do the kids even know what they're doing?
None of them. But again, it's even if they did understand or had an idea or an inkling, my child is going to represent my country. So what's more important at that point in time? Mm-hmm. And we go back to, this is a great platform for me to move on to bigger and better things. So when we're talking about third world countries, where we don't have access to Major League Baseball, to NFL, we don't have access to those professional established leagues, being an Olympian is the highest degree in athleticism. So if it's going to take for a guy to say, you know what, you just take this little pill, or you know what, I'm just going to give you a B12 shot.
Yeah.
What are they going to say, no?
I completely, it's not that I am sitting here pretending this isn't happening. And obviously, your personal experience with it, I was never even close to being an Olympian. I mean, in anything.
Not me either.
I never did. Maybe playing chess. If playing chess was an Olympic sport, I'd win. But I'm just, it's not really. So I defer to you, you know, in terms of that. But I also can't stand with cheating. That every single
I
can't do that. And I just, my favorite part of this is when the conspiracy theories come in. Mm-hmm. And because in 1984, I was just looking at the, you know, when Russia, like, didn't, as we well know, they boycotted the 1984. In the absence of the then USSR, the US medal count skyrocketed. Mm-hmm. It went to 174. And then when the Soviets started competing, it went down to 94. So it's not only, you know, the competitive balance also changes in the Olympics without the Russian athletes. And that's so sad. And the fact that we are casting this global blanket on all these Olympics, and that's where Anita's point comes in. The fact that now we think that every Russian athlete is a doper, it's so sad.
You know what?
So their hard work,
I understand. And that's the sad part, because I was in the Olympics in 2000, actually, 96, 2000, 2004.
Yeah.
And you can see the difference between these kids that come for the first Olympics to the second Olympics. I've had a chance to see kids coming into for a third Olympics. Yeah. You can see the difference. And steroids or doping in general will actually enhance, but it doesn't give you the genetic benefit or that predisposition to be at the elite. And I'm going to defer to baseball. We could argue till we're blue in the face. Can steroids really help you with eye-hand coordination? Not really. Does it help you with a bigger bat, the recovery period? Absolutely. But when we're dealing with kids, again, that only have this opportunity to shine and represent, it's really difficult to say no, especially when you're completely ignorant on the subject. And when you're representing the country 1, 2, 3 times, I'm going to defer to a country, very small country, who's very well known in boxing, Cuba.
Absolutely.
And when you're fighting over and over and over, day after day after day, making weight, and you're still training and you're still sparring, it's very difficult to be uninjured and unhurt for the next fight. Very difficult. So I am going to exhort to common sense. I'm not saying that I have proof for one or the other. I'm just saying it doesn't make sense.
I want to share, before we move on to our next topic, I want to share a quote from Usain Bolt. If we could pull that up. And this is what he had to say. The doping situation in track and field is getting really bad. And if you like, and if you feel like you need to make a statement, then thumbs up. This will scare a lot of people. It'll send a strong message that sport is serious.
Yes.
Now, again, I'll go back to the fact that I don't believe that all 68 Russian track and field athletes are doping. I do believe that there are a few in this bunch that, unfortunately, their dreams are getting destroyed. But I understand what Bolt is saying. He's saying that maybe this decision needs to be made for the greater good.
Yes.
In regard to what could happen.
The innocent will suffer for the guilty.
But at the end of the day, I still think it's very sad.
It's sad. I understand.
Of course, for more reasons than one. And again, this is why I said I had so much fun doing the show with you guys yesterday, because it's such unique perspectives and diverse perspectives, and I really appreciate it. And thank you for sharing your story there with that as well. Leicester City, both games available streaming live on Watch ESPN and the ESPN app. Oh, it's the new era with Max Kellerman. Stephen A. will be back. A lot of guests stopping by. We're going to have fun. You guys better tune in on Monday. John David Washington, Heisman candidates, Leonard Fournette, Deshaun Watson will all be on the show. Make sure you tune in. The new and improved First Take kicks off on Monday. Meanwhile, the countdown of all-time top 100 baseball players across all positions continues this week on ESPN.com. An expert panel, including Marley Rivera, our researcher David Spino, voted on thousands of head-to-head matchups of 162 players based on both peak performance and career value. Now, coming in at number 21 on this list was Alex Rodriguez. He was suspended for the entire 2014 season for his involvement in Biogenesis. Barry Bonds, Roger Clemens, who were also suspected of PED use, are expected to be in the top 20 when it is unveiled. Marley?
What would you like me to say?
You are very, very close to the sport, the subject, covering it in locker rooms constantly. Are you okay with this?
I couldn't be more okay with it.
Really?
My voice has been heard, and I have been very open, and I'm speaking to my BBWA members out there who don't get a little shout-outs on fancy television. So this
We're
is all
so
for
fancy
the
here.
For our baseball writers out there. I've had the discussion. We've had it in a couple of years. I'll be voting for the Hall of Fame and in Cooperstown, the MLB Hall of Fame.
I love that.
There we go.
Go, girl.
Yeah.
And one of the things that people always ask me is, will you vote for Alex Rodriguez? Will you vote for Barry Bonds? Will you vote for Roger Clemens? And my answer is unequivocally. Let's say that again. Unequivocally. Mm-hmm. I can't say it.
It's okay. I can say a
without
lot.
A doubt.
Without a doubt. Thank you, Claudia.
You're welcome.
Sin duda.
Absolutamente.
Without a doubt, yes. Si. And why? Because I don't believe, and you touched on it before, I don't believe that if you give Marley Rivera steroids systematically, whether they can find them in my body or not, that I can hit 700 home runs, that I can hit over 3,000 hits. So I do believe that steroids enhance your performance. They are called performance-enhancing drugs. They do, but I do think that it takes another level. But the main point here is not that one. The main point is that I widely believe, and now how you say that you believe that 90% of Olympic athletes did it, I believe that many of those also did it in MLB. And when we compare, and this is an argument that we've had many times in many clubhouses throwers, you know, toward, in Major League Baseball, we say, well, we always point out to the suspected steroid users, Barry Bonds, Alex Rodriguez, but what happens to the suspected steroid users on the pitching side? So maybe those pitchers were pitching juiced, and they still, you know, they still perform in a particular way. So I think it's very interesting that people focus on the power numbers because they are so impressive. And at the end of the day, with Mike Piazza getting inducted into the Hall of Fame, who was, and let's be very careful with this, suspected or tied to, nothing has ever been proven. Nothing has ever been really focused on Piazza, whether he was truly a steroid user or not. And I do not have an opinion on it because I don't have information about it. And I'm a reporter. So if I don't have information, I do not have an opinion about it. The point is that it may open some doors. And we have seen systematically how the voting, in the voting for the Hall of Fame, they've gone up. The percentages have gone up every year. In the beginning, Bonds and Clemens, who are both eligible for the Hall of Fame, have gone up. But in the case of Palmeiro and Mark McGwire, it never did.
Sammy Sosa.
So it just very, or Sammy Sosa, I don't know that Sammy Sosa has the numbers to make it into the Hall of Fame. I mean, in my opinion. But in the end, I think it's going to open some doors. And I think that eventually, maybe Barry will get in.
There are so many layers here that I don't think that there's enough actually time in the segment to really dive into.
Oh, we
into.
Have another hour.
Okay. but so many things, my mind is racing. To your point, okay, born and raised in Miami, covered Alex Rodriguez while Alex was in high school, was at his house when he signed his first contract with the Seattle Mariners as opposed to going to the University of Miami. I watched Alex play baseball in high school. He was a man amongst boys. You are absolutely right. He was kissed by God. He was blessed with unbelievable athletic talent. And in my opinion, at the end of the day, yes, does belong in Cooperstown. But you can't take, and I think you could say the same thing about Barry Bonds, okay? I think you could say the same thing about Roger. But at the end of the day, you can't, you have to understand that the PEDs that he utilized helped his numbers. Now, would he have great numbers? Without a shadow of a doubt, all these guys would. They'd have huge, huge successful careers in Major League Baseball. But by using performance-enhancing drugs, not only are you able to hit the ball further, pitch, you know, harder, stronger, more velocity, but also the longevity of your career.
I disagree. Couldn't disagree more. Longevity is one of the things that is directly affected by steroids. And I think that Alex and Barry have been an exception, maybe, if they both did steroids, and let's just do the if, right? Alleged steroid users, mm-hmm. because I actually believe and know for a fact of being covering baseball for so many years that steroids destroyed.
Okay.
They destroy your body.
Okay, so
But who's the guy who's had the most longevity in Major League Baseball? If we look at it right now, it's Ichiro Suzuki. It's about being healthy. It's about keeping your body healthy.
I disagree that steroids extend
your career.
But this is what I'm saying. In regard to longevity, in regard to how many get, like, the baseball seasons are really,
is
you
the
know
longest
it.
Season.
You know,
162
it's
a long, plus,
yeah.
absolutely.
So, yeah. So again, that's something else that steroids can do for you is maintain
that
productivity that you're going to get in that lengthy season. Now, but again, Marley, what I'm saying is I agree with you. These guys do belong in the Hall of Fame. My thing is, and I've talked about this on my radio show before, is I think Cooperstown should have an area.
Carlos Beltran told me, I said, what do you think about this? Carlos Beltran is right now putting numbers that are getting him maybe close to becoming a Hall of Famer. And he said, and I asked him, what do you think about it? And he goes, there should be a hall for the dopers. There should be an asterisk. But how do we prove it?
A doping hall.
How do we prove it?
Wait, but time out. That's not what I said. Wait, I don't agree with that.
Okay.
I'm not saying that there should be a hall. Oh, okay, well, here's all the dopers.
Here's the doping wing and here's the...
No, that's not what I'm saying. I'm saying, what's the timeline for the steroid era, let's say? What, 1990-something?
The late 90s to the early 2000s.
Okay.
Sorry, peak, but it's steroid eras right now. We see the suspensions all the time. Biogenesis just caught the largest suspension ever happened last year.
And before that, Balco, and it had been doing...
So I don't know that we can call it.
I understand what you're saying.
And back then they were legal. They weren't illegal.
I know.
Mandarone was legal.
No, they were not illegal.
My point is, have you been to Cooperstown? You're walking around when you get to that area, there should be some type of acknowledgement that this was the steroid era. I'm not saying that you should just pinpoint certain guys and put them in that era. I'm just saying it should be distinguished as from this date to this date.
But
dudes were juicing.
But you're saying
dudes
that
were juicing.
But then that's blanket stating all of them,
yeah,
like
because,
the Russian.
Because Molly,
the same with the Russian track.
But
then you're taking your young kids there, and it's like, oh, they
Anita,
got here.
Molly, there are so many players that don't, that
Anita, biogenesis,
drugs that didn't get caught.
But the biggest suspension.
We'll never know.
I understand what
you're
saying.
We're preaching to the choir, woman.
I understand what you mean by the steroid era, which is the peak of it. But the largest, you know, suspensions, because the testing has become so much better in Major League Baseball, happened last year. So then what are we going to do? We're going to go steroid era is all of baseball. It's happened all the time. There was a peak when there were being 70 home runs hit. Then maybe we can say that.
There was a peak where it was 61.
The biggest suspensions happened last year. 14 people got caught under the biogenesis scandal. So we're going to say, oh, it happened between 1998 and 2004. It happened in 2015. The biggest suspensions. I'm sorry, 14.
I don't think
just a note, specifically, there's different kinds of steroids, and the steroids have changed throughout history.
I've learned the names. They're very long.
Yeah. And we can shorten them up. But the truth of the matter is, it doesn't matter what we're testing for today. Trust me, whatever they were taking yesterday is way advanced. So it's going to be very difficult to really pinpoint what era is really the doping era.
Yeah.
Because...
Yeah. I mean, honestly, it's commonly known as the steroid era, so I get to Anita's point.
It's more of a timeline rather than a really specific process. Absolutely. And as much as I respect the protocols that Major League Baseball is using in order to maintain random testing and what have you, the truth of the matter is their drugs, what they're doing right now, what athletes are doing right now, are undetected. And
a lot of them are very well detected.
Yeah, but I understand. And it also depends, you know, on what? The purse, how much money they have, and how much money they're willing to spend on it.
There you go.
That's the difference. Economics. Yes.
Dinero, mamita.
Mula.
It always comes down to that, right?
Yes.
You always want more of it. That was a great conversation, you guys. Thank you for that. Up next, we are going to the NBA. Durant caught a lot of flack since signing with Golden State, but he says he doesn't care about his legacy. Do we believe him? We get into it.
Okay.
Coming up.
Go Tupac.
I'm saying that promo in my sleep. I have the whole thing memorized. It is finally Monday. We can't wait. Meanwhile, in an extensive interview with The Vertical, Kevin Durant was asked if he cares about being liked after his decision to leave the Thunder and sign with the Golden State Warriors. Here's a quote on this. No, I don't. I want to be liked by people that I think love me. people I don't know, I don't care about. I want you to respect my game, what I bring to the floor, and if you don't like what I do as a person, I don't care. I want you to respect my game, and if you don't, that's your problem. But I don't want to be liked. Anita, are you buying it? What do you make of these?
No, why did he stay in bed for 2 days in the Hamptons?
Aww.
What do you mean? why are you, I mean, you make this amazing decision to go to the Golden State Warriors, and then you hibernate for a few days? I mean, listen, Hamptons are fun. Get out, enjoy it. But
you've never broken up with a boyfriend.
What?
Even if you didn't like him.
That's not why he was hibernating. He was hibernating. This is a quote from him. I didn't leave my bed because I was like, man, if I walk outside, somebody might just try to hit me with their car or say something negative to me. I just stayed in and tried to process it all. It felt different. It felt very different. So, no, I'm not buying it. Come on. Let's face it. Look at us. In the breaks, we're like looking at Twitter. I mean, you know, we get some negative Twitter feedback, but we are getting a lot of positive, but we read it. We want people to like us. I mean, that's human nature. You want people to like you, whether it's your family, whether it's people who you love or love you, whatever the case may be. Another thing, I want to share another quote with you, which this really, I liked what he had to say here, but I'm not buying it either. Okay. How do you define legacy? He said, I don't even know what your legacy means. I look at legacy and I associate that with family. As a basketball player, what I've done, when I'm done playing, and look at what I did, I understand what he's saying, and it's very noble to say that, but why'd you go to Golden State? You went to Golden State because you need to win championships.
Of course.
Because this day and age, in our sports society, how do we size someone up?
Rings.
How many? Bling, bling. How many rings do you have? I'll sit here and I will say that I think Dan Marino is a top three quarterback ever to play in the NFL. Exactly. And what's the argument? How many Super Bowls does he want in a year?
Zero.
Well, zero. Unfortunately, this is how we really judge athletes. And this is why he went to Golden State. Let's face it. I mean, he went there to win championships. So, and it is going to dictate his legacy. Mm. Now, are we going to sit back 10, 15? Let's say, hypothetically speaking, Golden State Warriors, they win four more championships with Kevin Durant. 10, 15 years from now, are we going to be sitting back and, you know, sipping on a nice rosé in the Hamptons and saying, but don't forget, look who he won it with. Yeah, I mean,
you're from Oklahoma City.
But we say that about LeBron.
We do right now, and nobody is more than me. Okay, we do right now, but 10, 15 years from now, are we really going to look back and say, man, that LeBron, he really was at that point in time, and at that point in time, we might be even talking about him being the greatest of all time, mm-hmm, and surpassing Michael Jordan. Are we going to look back and really and talk about his time in Miami and talk about the shot that Ray Allen hit while the Spurs were almost popping the bubbly in the locker room? I don't think we are. I don't think we are. But come on, man up. You care about your legacy. You went to the Golden State Warriors to win championships because we as a sports society, that is how we dictate your legacy is championships.
The, okay, word, the part that I hate is the whole villainous traitor because he chose a business move. It's a business. Since when sports became a charity? Since when is sports? Sports is business. Good for you. Go where the money is and the rings are. I'm okay with that. And this is coming from a Cleveland Cavaliers fan who hated when LeBron went to Miami. But you know what? Good for you that you want him over there.
Yeah.
Sports is business, not charity. So all of a sudden, he's the villain because I get it, Oklahoma. I get it. It hurts when your favorite player leaves. It hurts. You burned the jersey. You did all these things.
Really?
I kept mine.
I was just...
But, you know, you do all these things, and then you go, but you know what? It's business. So because the decision is not popular. So I think, like, when you extrapolate it to that, and I'm with you on this, and come on, it hurts you a little, Kevin. It's okay to admit that it did.
But there's a
right. Don't pretend to be someone else that it didn't. It didn't hurt you to leave the place that you built up, this franchise that is fantastic. You know what? To be honest, and I know people are going to hate me and I'm going to get all the comments. I didn't even know there was a team in Oklahoma City for a long time until Kevin Durant was there. And I admit it. You can hate me on Twitter. I'm okay with that. It's okay.
You
know what?
You're okay.
I also didn't know that when my first hockey game, I also thought I sat in the seat at the Madison Square Garden and waited for the fourth quarter. I did. I had no idea. I'm Puerto Rican, people. I'm sorry. I didn't know that hockey experience. I know it.
I was 15.
This should be the come clean segment.
Okay. Let's start with Who has not broken up with a boyfriend even though they didn't like him and felt guilty about it? And then you start groveling, wondering, did I do the right thing?
But of course.
Guy, he treated me well.
Yeah.
Well, it's the same thing. You go through that whole mental process.
And you hide in your house.
Yes,
Oklahoma City
treated him beautiful. The Thunder glorified him. He was the star. And all of a sudden, he's going to pick up, and we'll touch upon why he picked up and left. And he's going to Golden State looking for that ring.
You know what? If you like it, put a ring on it.
Exactly.
That's it.
And
that's
he's
what he's
looking
doing,
for
putting
that
a ring on it.
And you
you're
know what?
When we need
he uprooted, think about
it.
This. He uprooted his family, he uprooted his kids, and he's moving everybody to the West Coast.
Sorry.
And he's going to put a ring on it. Trust
he's
me,
put a
he
ring
will.
On it.
And to that being said, it cannot be easy to spend all this time and be invested in a team and just get up
so
and
Claudia, how about the tattoo?
I love the tattoo. I love ink. I cannot deny it.
You love the tattoo?
If you have nothing nice to say, don't say it at all. But we are going to talk about it a little bit later in the show. But I will say this. I do think you can reach a point. Obviously, you want people to like you. But I think you do reach a point when you're getting so much criticism. You say, you know what? I don't care anymore. I just want people to respect me. And I think maybe he's reaching that because he knows that's what's coming. Respect my game. Not everybody's going to like me. Even if I try to act perfectly, we all, you know, you realize that in life.
One of the biggest storylines I'm going to be paying attention to. Some people thrive in this environment. Okay, we're calling him like now it's the attention is off LeBron and now he's the villain this year, right? Coming into the NBA.
There always has to be one.
But this is the thing. There are certain players or certain men, there are certain athletes that can thrive in that environment.
Yes.
And there's ones who cannot.
Fold.
My eye. What? I'm very curious.
You don't know if he can handle it?
I don't know. Okay. And I think this is going to be one of the most interesting storylines moving forward for Kevin Durant this year.
Golden State is going to embrace
him. In this environment.
All eyes.
Golden State is going to embrace him.
No question. Going to be on that team. Yep. We see it. We see you.
I don't have one.
You'll be getting offers soon. Coming up, Greg Hardy might be getting another chance in the NFL. That is the latest, and we will share our opinions on that subject. Can't wait to hear what you ladies have to say when we come back. Where? Ray Rice has been out of football since 2014 when he was cut by the Ravens after video surfaced of him knocking out his then fiance in a casino elevator. He's ready to get back to the NFL and told USA Today that he's willing to donate his entire salary for 2016 if he signed. This coming on the same day, free agent defensive end Greg Hardy visited and worked out for the Jaguars, but ESPN sources say the team has no plans to sign him. Hardy was suspended the first four games of last season for his role in a domestic violence incident in 2014. Marley, I want to start with you. What's your reaction that Greg Hardy continues to have teams looking at him while Ray Rice is willing to volunteer his salary to get a shot?
The bottom line is that sports aren't about character or the kind of person that you are about performance. So if Ray Rice doesn't ever play again, it's because teams have concluded he can no longer be a contributing member to this team. If Greg Hardy does, it's because they've concluded that he can contribute to this team.
100% with you.
I can't get out of my head the amount of women in Baltimore who wore Ray Rice jerseys and gave him a standing ovation when he walked into that stadium. But that's not unique, and I'm not saying anything against the Baltimore fan base. Nothing. And I love that city. Love it. It's not unique to them because every single fan base cares about the performance on their team. If the player's in the other team, if you're over there, if you're on the other one, you're the villain, you're the wife beater. But if you're in my team and you wear my uniform, then it's a different story. So the scrutiny is different. And bringing it to baseball, the fact that the MLB and the MLBPA, they reached the first agreement on joint domestic violence, which happened exactly after, quote unquote, and just to use an NFL term, the fumble that we know that Roger Goodell did in Ray Rice in the beginning that later was corrected. And they have a domestic league violence policy. I'm sorry, a domestic violence policy for the league in place where you get a specific amount of games, supposedly, but you really don't. And they have this landmark statement where now we saw our oldest Chapman get 30 games. We saw Jose Reyes get 52, and we saw 82 for Hector Oliveira, which pains me that I'm mentioning not only people that I like and respect, which is very, very hard. These are players that are very talented that I respect and actually really admire some of them. And it's very difficult as a reporter to just kind of toe that line. And as a woman, but you know what? Our oldest Chapman right now is considered the main trading chip for the Yankees because it's all about performance. And he gets standing ovations at Yankee Stadium. And Greg Hardy will get standing ovations. Ray Rice, maybe he won't get the opportunity because he can't play anymore, apparently.
Well, don't forget Jose Reyes just a few weeks ago,
absolutely.
Right?
I was there.
With the Mets fan base. Yeah. You were there. You were at the game.
Yeah.
You're absolutely right. This is what I look at. You know that scale of justice?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, some of them still exist out there.
It's supposed to be blind.
Okay.
Yeah.
But it's supposed to be. But I you're right. I kind of look at this. Like, okay, what does Ray Rice still have left in the tank, right? By the way, let's let people know. We're talking about $885,000. $885,000. That would be his salary if
that's
he was
all
to play. Seven-year vet, by the way. So you know, what does Ray Rice still have in the tank? Obviously, a lot of NFL teams don't think he has much. Now, there were a lot of injuries last year that happened at the running back position. And I think Ray Rice could have contributed to a team but didn't get the call. Why? Because the off-the-field issues, calling him in, the media circus that would happen, the video that would be played over and over and over again that we have seen time and time again far outweighs what they feel Ray Rice can contribute to a team. Where Greg Hardy, I think it's a different situation. You got to work out with the Jacksonville Jaguars.
But it's not the same thing.
Right.
But
he's not dragging you by the hair.
But what Greg Hardy can contribute to a team, the scale of justice is different.
Yeah, Ray Rice, let's be honest. The year before, he had a down year.
Yeah.
I don't have the exact numbers in front of me, but like the 4 years prior.
Yeah, his last year before he's
And that's really what it was. I think it's a combination of both, but I think it's more so that, they don't think, to your point, that he's going to be as much production.
But I'll use the word shocked. I was shocked that somebody did not bring him in.
Or
At least for a tryout, a workout.
Especially based.
See what he can do. But again, it's because that scale, that video,
I think the video
has more weight than what they thought the Ray Rice can contribute.
And I'm going to revert to what you said about the NBA. It's all about business.
No.
At the end of the game, I need an element that's going to take me from point A to point B. And if that's Hardy, so be it. You know what? And yes, there are pictures. They're not as available. They were not all over the place. I mean, that video
was everywhere.
And you can still download it. And it was, to me, it was appalling.
Mm-hmm.
The pictures,
they're appalling as well.
Yeah, but they're not as brutal. And it didn't make
so
him
graphic.
Look as animalistic. It was almost barbaric.
But then again, Ray Rice is doing, and let's say, and it's something that Molly mentioned before when we were off the air, he's doing the right thing now.
Yes, he
right?
is.
So
he's become the poster child
of
anti-domestic
doing what you're
violence.
Supposed to do. So has Jose Reyes.
Could it be
so
a have,
and
they
what
are
about
taking
Greg Hardy?
Perhaps.
He hasn't.
So he has. I mean, I don't think he's even ever admitted that he did something wrong.
Did you see the interview with Adam
there
Schefter where he was unaware at all? He showed no remorse.
The only thing he's done is he changed his Twitter picture to a smiley face. To a happy face.
Yeah. So then you sit down. So Ray Rice has said, Ray Rice has said, I'm not justifying in any way. And I think that every time we play that video, we victimize Jhené Rice again. And it's very, mm-hmm. very difficult for me to watch it.
Yes.
But the point
is. That's a great point. It's not fair for her to keep having to
read
that and her family.
And you know what? That family is trying to put it back together. Mm-hmm. They're trying to do something about it, which is better than most of them do.
Yeah.
So maybe, but the only reason, like I said it from the beginning,
it's
if he doesn't play, it's because, I'm sorry, if they don't pick him up, it has nothing to do with media attention. It's
no.
He can't play.
But it's because, in bottom line, business. I need this element that's going to take me from point A to point B. And if you're not it, it doesn't matter how good you're doing, you're a buck short and a day late.
But it's not even about getting signed. It's a workout. It's a cup of coffee. It's coming in and seeing and having the coaching staff watch and having the medical staff look at him and say, what do you have in the tank? I mean, we sit here and we're assuming that he really doesn't have anything left. And we're basing it, you made an excellent point, Molly. You said, you know, he ended on a very bad note.
In 2013,
yeah. But do we know? We don't know. He's not even getting a tryout because all the off-the-field circus mm-hmm. that's going to come into play with the media far outweighs what they think he'll be able to contribute.
And again, I just want to add, I do appreciate, like you said, that he's done everything he can to turn this around and to make it better, the best of his ability. As for Greg Hardy, we did not see that remorse and with the Cowboys last season when he was with them. Coming up, an NBA player is showing Tupac some love. Stay tuned to find out who it is. We'll get into it.
First Take is brought to you by Infinity, luxury cars that deliver inspired performance. And Office Depot Office Max, gear up for great.
KD, he got some new ink, guys. It's a picture of Tupac covering most of his lower leg. You can see it there. Whoever did the artwork, it's beautiful. Looks just like him. And then at the bottom of the tattoo, he has the logo of Wu-Tang Clan. So, ladies, jump in wherever you want. I just want to get your thoughts on this.
Well, pretty interesting. I just read that Wu-Tang apparently had made a comment that, Tupac's death changed hip-hop forever.
Fair.
So, maybe that's... I mean, I know we're trying to analyze a tattoo.
This is it. I'm gonna steal because I know nothing about this. I'm not even gonna pretend. I'm gonna steal some quote from our producer Stephanie Frenier, and she said, "Does this mean that LeBron has to get a Biggie tattoo now?"
Fair.
So there we go.
And
that's
Antoine
it.
Had something to say. We should add what Antoine said.
Well, yeah.
He should get an E40 tattoo.
There it is.
There's a real relationship.
Really Bay Area.
Yes. Well, I love ink.
Yeah.
I love ink, and whatever it is that Tupac.
I love it. Yeah. With all due respect to that artist, I can't unsee that. I can't unsee it. I don't like
that. That bad? No.
I mean, again, we're analysis on a tattoo. Obviously, he's moving out to the Bay Area. Yeah. We know Tupac, West Coast rapper. Yeah. And again, I just read Wu-Tang, you know, said that the Tupac
and
passing.
It's his body.
Hip hop forever.
It's his body.
So,
obviously, he has some connection. Do what you want to do, right?
Instances in life, whether it's a breakup with a boyfriend, whatever the case may be, and we get a tattoo because it's significant.
Yeah, yeah. What's up with the breakup with the boyfriend?
That's all I have to say. Thank God for laser removal.
Marley thinks he might not be appreciated.
Thank God for lasers.
Katie, do what you want. We're all over this guy. I had so much fun with you ladies.
I
Marley,
know.
Claudia, Anita, I really appreciate it. Thank you.
Bring it in, Claudia.
See you Monday. It's the new era with Max Kellerman.
All that.